Tonight, we're excited to present guests Shawn Preston and Tor Wager as the very first event in the program's year-long series reflecting on the extraordinary aspects of the most common element of our humanity, the senses. Through next April, we'll explore how contemporary artists, scholars, and designers are creating and studying ways to stimulate and to satiate the multifaceted senses, influencing our interactions and knowledge of the world and of ourselves. And magician Shawn Preston will begin this year-long investigation. We're very proud to have Shawn with us this evening, returning to the college where he once studied graphic design. Preston is based in Denver and has performed his quick, witty, exceptional sleight of hand for nearly 20 years. His ability to deceive the senses will provide unique insight to our series and to Dr. Wager's talk. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Shawn Preston.
How is everybody? That's what I like to hear. Well, I wanted to show you something kind of cool. Check it out, right here. Thank you. She could tell right away that I was bad to the bone. One more. Bad to the bone. Not quite figure drawing. There in the back. I'm totally messing with you. I love that part. They're like, Well, I'm very happy to be here. I know a lot of you guys are thinking, how does a male model find the time to do magic? I make the time. Matter of fact, I actually do this full time. A number of years ago, I stopped as I was a graphic designer for many years. As she mentioned, went to this very school, but several years ago, I decided to stop doing graphic design and pursue my passion, which was my passion from a child, which is that of magic. And I'm very fortunate, I get to travel all over the country doing magic comedy, sleight of hand, that sort of thing. In fact, I just did a big tour of all the cities in Wyoming. what? In fact, I've been doing so much traveling, I decided to get a map. You know, the kind you put up on a wall, you put a pushpin in for all the cities you visit. Then it occurred to me the first two places I should go should be the top corners. So I could pin it to the wall. Try to keep up, dude. In fact, just recently I was in a great little town called Rock Springs, Wyoming. You guys heard of it? Rock Springs? Great little town. I stayed at this bed and breakfast. The sign out front said, "We treat you like family." And sure enough, 6 o'clock in the morning, somebody was banging on the door going, "Why don't you get a real job?" Just like home. But I came back to good news, very excited to share this with you guys. I just signed a major contract with HBO. Thank you. It's pretty awesome. I get the first 3 months for free. $9.99 after that, I'm locked in. Yes. So I was thinking about what would I share with you guys? I mean, what are some of the things that are similar between artists? You know, what is a common thing amongst artists? And the one thing that I kept coming back to, is imagination. See, I think any kind of artist, whether you're a visual artist or a performing artist, I think you have to have imagination. And my job as a magician is to stretch your imagination and to give you that sense of wonder. So I wanted to just try just a quick little experiment. By show of hands, how many of you guys think you have a good imagination? Oh, good. That's excellent. So what I want you guys to do is imagine right now, I'll try and help you with the visual aid. I want you to imagine that I've tossed you this lemon. And I want you to imagine when you catch it, you can feel the weight of the lemon. You might actually be able to feel the texture of it. You hold it up, you can actually maybe smell the zest of the peel of the lemon. In fact, if I was to take a knife and cut open the lemon. You might actually feel the texture of the knife cutting into the lemon. You might actually feel the juices running down your arms. You might actually lean down and taste the juices, feel the bitterness on your tongue. How many of you actually are imagining that? So if I've done my job, then everything is perfect. And I've actually altered your reality, because this, in fact, is not a knife. This is actually just a fork. And this is actually not a lemon. This is actually just a crumpled up piece of paper. And you guys have a very strong imagination. Now, I want to enlist the aid of some people from the audience, and let's see, maybe you can help me out just real quick here. What's your name?
Drew?
Good memory, Drew. would you mind coming just for a second here? Here's what I want to do. I've enlisted Drew to help me out. What I'd like you to do is I'm going to have you take these books, and I want you to pass them out to a few people in the audience, and you know, try to make sure you spread it out pretty good, okay? Pass out all five of the books. I should mention, I picked up some interesting ones here. I have the War of Art. I have The Magic of Believing. That seemed to be appropriate. I have, this is a thriller. Murder at Midnight. I have Graphic Design Thinking Beyond Brainstorming. And then I also have The Successful Artist's Career Guide, Finding Your Way in the Business of Art. There you go. What I want you to do, just like I said, pass out those books amongst some people in the audience. And while Drew is doing that, I'm going to enlist the aid of one more person, if I could. And it's going to be you right there. Yes, you. Let's give her a big round of applause. Come on. Come right on over here, my dear. Yeah, all the way up, all the way. That's it. Yep. Don't be shy. Yeah, keep it going for her. Fantastic. Thanks for helping out. What's your name?
Kaylin.
Kaylin? That's my middle name. That's cool. Come on over here. Now, Kaylin, I have something you may or may not be familiar with. I have some markers here. These are poster markers. Only five of them, and I also have a picture, a portrait that my son did of me. Now, my son is 8 years old. He did this a couple years ago. Here it is. Quite the likeness, huh? Yeah? Very proud of this picture. Caitlin, I'm going to let you color in the picture. Now, we're going to do this. It's important. Are you right-handed or left-handed?
Okay.
Left-handed? Me too, right there. So what you're going to do is you're going to hold the board like this in your right arm. You're going to reach over, and one at a time, you're going to pick a color. Now, not yet. Not yet. Put it back. Don't get crazy on me. Calm down. Calm down. You're going to stand there so that even if I do turn around, I won't be able to see what you're coloring in. You're going to hold it so that the back of the board is facing me. I'm going to stand over here with my back towards you, okay? Now, we're going to use one color at a time to fill in that drawing, and at the end, we're going to use all five colors, but only once, each color one time. Does that make sense?
Yep.
Okay. When you're done with the color, just so that there's no confusion, just set the color down on the table instead of back into the cup. So at the end, should be no colors in the cup.
Okay.
Cool?
Yep.
We're good?
Yep.
All right. Ready? I'm going to stand over here. And now I'm going to kind of direct you, so don't jump ahead or anything. What I want you to do is go ahead and grab a color. Do you have one? Okay. What I want you to do, I want you to color in my shirt on that picture, the shirt. And you don't obviously just scribble it in, but scribble it in enough that everybody will be able to see what color each particular piece is. And I forgot to ask, are you a student here?
Yes.
You are. And what are you studying?
Interior design.
Okay, this I was hoping for a fashion design student, but that's okay. All right, and are you done coloring in the shirt?
Yes.
Okay, perfect, set that color down. And go ahead and pick another color. You're good? All right, let's see. I want you to, Actually, I want you to put that color back because I want to see if I can change your decision a little bit. I want you to go with the, and yeah, it's okay to put it back in the cup. I want you to pick the color you are the least attracted to. You got it? All right. I want you to color in the pants, if you don't mind. Color in the pants. I just hear a bunch of good. Set that marker down. If you haven't already selected it, I'm not sure what you picked the first time, but pick the color that you're most attracted to. Okay, I want you to color in the shoes. Done? Okay, so you should have two colors left. Okay, this time just kind of go with your intuition and just grab a color. I don't want any necessarily. You got one?
Yep.
Okay, color in the hair, and you can go outside of the lines in that too. But you know, color it in nice and good so that, I mean, right? That's creativity. Going outside the lines, outside the box. Good. Should have one color left. Yeah, have you taken the last color? Go ahead and take the last color. And go ahead and color in my glasses. You can color in the lenses and then maybe outline around the glasses in the picture. All done? Okay, so we should have no colors left. Perfect, let's see how you did. Ooh, look at that, that is, there's some creativity. Yeah? So it's kind of hard to tell in the light. It looks like we have orange hair, blue glasses, a green shirt. It looks like red, I think. It's hard to tell the difference, but we got red pants and purple shoes. But do you ever wonder if our decisions are in fact our own? Because I don't know if you noticed, but I also had this sitting here the entire time. You see, I actually colored in the exact same picture earlier, and I want you to see that I actually colored in orange hair, blue glasses, a green shirt, red pants, and purple shoes. Well done right there, my dear. And I'm gonna let you keep this fabulous piece of art.
Yes.
Hell, you just keep the whole thing. Give her a big round of applause. Awesome. And a high five, yeah. Now, how many of my helpers out there have a book? Who has a, if you don't mind, just so I can see where you're at, if you wouldn't mind, stand up for me. Fantastic. All right. And so there's a couple of you there. Drew, could you help me out one more time?
Yep.
Yeah. In fact, I have one other book here. In fact, you know what would be helpful? Would you folks join me up on stage?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah.
I know. She's like, no, don't do it. Come on up. And Drew, come on up yourself. Let's big round of applause for all of them. Come on. I've got an extra book just for you.
Beautiful.
I'll come back to you. Just make a line right here, my friends. Excellent, excellent. Make some room for you. Ladies and gentlemen, my lovely assistants. All right. Drew, all the way down there on the end, I'm going to start with you. It was Drew, right?
Yep.
Yeah. I'm going to start with you, if that's okay. I'm going to come around over here, kind of sneak in. Fantastic. I know you just got the book, but I want you to flip through it, check it out. Everything is good?
It looks like a book.
It looks like a book. Thanks for helping out.
You're welcome.
So I'm just going to riffle right down the corner like that. You're going to say stop wherever you stop me. That's going to be your page, okay?
Beautiful.
Here we go.
Stop.
Right there. I want you to look at the first word on that. This right here where I'm pointing. Mm-hmm. First word, you got it?
Yep.
Don't forget your word.
Okay.
All right, I want you to concentrate on your word. I'm going to see if I can pick it up. Here, hang on to that for a sec. I'm going to say, starts with an A. Mm-hmm. L-O-N-G, your word is along.
It is.
Yes. Awesome. Now, yeah, you're going to help me out for everybody else. What I want you to do is open up the book to any page you want, somewhere in the middle, any page you want.
On everyone else's book?
No, just on yours.
Gotcha.
Okay, what are you on? 92?
Yep.
Perfect. I'll take the book. Give Drew a big round of applause. Thank you very much for your help.
Yeah.
Fantastic. You can hang out or you can rush back to your seat, whatever
Great.
You'd like.
I'll go back.
I thought you might. So Drew selected page 92. I want each of you guys to open up your books to page 92, but do me a favor, hold the books up close so that there's no way that I can see. I don't want to look into the books. And in fact, to make this interesting, I'm going to come down there. Always wanted to see what my show looked like from the from down here. So what I want you guys to do is look at the first word on page 92. And right here, what's your name, sir?
Ian.
Ian, I'm picking up something kind of interesting from you. What I want you to do is I want you to step over here to the end, and I'm going to come back to you. I'm going to come back to you at the very end. Okay? All right. I want you all to look at the very first word on page 92 for me. I'm going to see if I can pick up on your thoughts. I'm going to start right over here with you. I want you to look at the word, visualize it. I'll come back to you. Actually, does your word start with the letter P? No. It must be your word then. Okay, you got to turn down the volume. You're thinking a little loud. I'm seeing a P and E and R. C, E. Oh, this is an interesting word. You're thinking of the word perceive? Yeah? Yes. Big round of applause right there. Very good, very good. Thank you very much. Jumping over here, you your word does not start with a P. In fact, starts with a D. Maybe that's where I was. Is it a D and then an E? V-O-T-E, is your word devote? Devoted? Yes, okay, good, that's two for two. What I'd like you to do is I want you to look over the first line on page 92, the first line, and pick out a long word for me, a long word. Same thing for you, look at page 92, look at the first line, actual body copy, not a headline. If there's a headline on your page, don't worry about the headline. Look at the first line of body copy, and I'm going to say like Times New Roman, 10 point. I want you to pick out a long word somewhere in that line, okay? Do you have one? Yeah, a long word? Yeah, how about you, long word? Okay, is there an E in your word? Is the E the last letter? It is. Does it start with an S? It does. Okay, good. I'm seeing an S, a U, an R. You are a very visual person. As I'm seeing like the top of something, maybe the surface. Is that your word? Surface? Yes. Okay, good. And then right over here, when I asked you to pick out a long word, you did indeed pick out a long word, did you? I don't know if you counted them in your mind, counted the letters in your mind, but you kind of jumped back and forth between different words, but you settled on one, and it was a long word, correct? Yeah? I'm going to say it starts with a C. Yeah? An O, an L. Were you thinking of the word collaborate or collaborative? It is the word collaborative? Yeah? Yes! Now I'm going to be honest with you folks. Everybody has this ability. I'm just a little more full of it. Last person. I'm going to come to you in just a second. I want everybody to give my four helpers right here a big round of applause. You guys can just set the books right down on the table right behind you and make your way back to your seats. Thank you very much. Ian, what I want you to do now, because think about this, Drew, you opened up to page 92. Subsequently, I had everybody turn to page 92. Some of you might be thinking, maybe, just maybe, I memorized the first word on every page in every book. Pretty silly, but, you know, somebody could be thinking that. So I'm going to try this with you. What I want you to do is open up the book to any page other than page 92.
If it doesn't have the number I want.
Oh, well, I can't really help you there, my friend. Good?
Got it.
I want you to scan over that page, and I want you to pick out a word, but make sure it's a long word, 9 or 10 letters, something like that. In other words, I don't want you picking the word, you know, what or who or something like that. Make sure it's a good, challenging word. I mean, I like a challenge.
Okay, ready.
You ready?
Yes.
All right. Concentrate on your word. I'm going to see if I can get into your thoughts. A word in hundreds of thousands, literally. Does your word, I'm not exactly sure. I'm kind of seeing just kind of a jumble right now, but that's okay. Does your word start with an S? No. Is there an S in the word? There is. But is this a word you're familiar with? Okay. Okay, I'm kind of all over the board. I need you to focus in, and I need you to help me out with just the first letter. What is just the first letter of your word?
V.
Sorry?
V.
V? Okay, V. Okay, think about the next letter in your word. The next letter. Okay. Go on to the next letter. Okay. I think I have it. And this might be why I was seeing an S. I was thinking of more of a square shape. Does that make sense to you? That might have been where I was getting the S. For the very first time, what was the word that you picked out of thousands and thousands? What was the word?
Video cassette.
No, seriously.
Video cassette.
Oh, it was? Good, that's exactly what I got. Give Ian a big round of applause. Up here, my friend. Yes! My people. I should mention, I don't have any kind of a special ability. I don't see dead people. Pretty crazy, isn't it? Yeah? Spooky. Do we have time for one more? Do we have time?
Yes.
Yeah? Okay, should we do a real quick one?
Yeah?
Does somebody have an iPhone I can borrow real quick? Just an iPhone? Yeah, you have one there? And could you unlock it for me? Unlock it? You don't remember your, how do you use your phone? Perfect. And do you, you don't mind if I look at your photos, do you? Because wow, dude, seriously. Wow, landscape mode even, that's, I'm just messing with you. It's just the calculator. Could you help me out just real quick?
Yeah.
Here's what I want you to do. I want you to punch in a two-digit number for me. Two digits. Any two digits. It's okay if I see them, dude. I've seen the trick. Yeah, just two digits. Now, we're going to hit times, okay? And then, you mind? You want it? Yeah? Come on. Punch in two digits for me. Two digits. Here we go. Now hit times. Perfect. All right. Let's. I'm going to come all the way over here. Yeah. Okay. Two digits. Any two. All right, and hit times. And we're going to do one more. Drew, help me out. I want you to hit, let's do three digits. I'm going to try and speed this up here and hit equals for me. Perfect, perfect. And here, come get your phone real quick. In fact, would you mind coming up, helping me up here? Woo! Big round of applause. Real quick. I want you to read off this number. See, the Greek mathematician Pythagoras said that numbers are the root of the universe. Read off that number for me, the total.
10,716,701.
That's 10,716,701. Here's what's interesting. Today's date is October. That's the 10th month. Today's the 7th, 2016. And if you look at your phones right now, it says 701. Right there. Guys, it's been an absolute pleasure. Thanks for having me back. If you enjoyed my show, my name is Shawn Preston, and if you didn't, my name is David Copperfield. Thank you and good night. Thank you.
I'd first like to introduce Tor Wager. Dr. Wager is a professor of psychology and neuroscience at the University of Colorado in Boulder and the director of the university's Cognitive and Affective Neuroscience Lab, or CAN Lab, correct? The work at CAN Lab has been featured on NPR, PBS, National Geographic, Wired, and many other news services. The lab is supported by multiple sources, including the National Science Foundation, the Michael J. Fox Foundation, and the MacArthur Foundation. Dr. Wager's research focuses on the brain mechanisms underlying affective experiences. Among other related concerns, the lab investigates the effects of thoughts, prior experiences, and expectations, particularly in relation to placebo effects, cognitive regulation of emotion, and social influences. Dr. Wager will share some of what the lab has discovered with us this evening. Specifically, he'll describe the relationship between what comes in through our senses and what we perceive and feel emotionally. Be prepared to discover that even your basic sensory emotions, like how the air feels on your skin right now, or what you are absolutely sure you saw Shawn Preston do, that these feelings are at their heart not veridical representations of the external world. They are what Wager will describe as conceptual acts, dependent upon your beliefs, your past, and projections even into the future. Though the mind-body relationship might seem like magic in some cases, Wager will present a picture grounded in neuroscientific evidence of how and why this constructive process occurs, allowing us to apply a new understanding in our exploration of the senses of illusion, creativity, and art. So please join me in welcoming Tor Wager.
As you'll see, you know, I don't usually talk about art, but I'm going to try to talk a little bit about art today, which is stretching my boundaries a little bit. I know that hearing about the brain might be stretching some boundaries for some of you, so we'll meet in the middle. And if I'm talking about art and I get in trouble, I'll just fall off the stage or something like that. So what is a conceptual act? This is a term that my friend and colleague Lisa Feldman Barrett coined. And we think of what we see, what we hear, what we touch, what we smell as something that happens to us. But the idea of a conceptual act is that this is a creative process, that these experiences are things that we actually create in our heads. And if so, then we might have some limited control over them. This is a picture of the visual system according to René Descartes in the 1600s. And as you can see here, things come in the eyes and they're projected onto the pineal gland, which is the window to the soul. It interprets all the visual input. So it's really like a little movie camera inside your brain that's projected onto this, this organ that has a special sense of communication. I don't know what the pineal actually does. Nobody does, I don't think. But certainly it doesn't have any special privileged access to the soul. And this is a more modern view, but it still has this vestiges of this idea that what we see is some projection of the veridical world. So here you see this person here, and the visual input goes in, crosses at the optic chiasm, and is projected onto the primary visual cortex in this relatively veridical way. And that's true, but that's not really how we see the world at all. In the old days, this is reflected in, I think, in art, in our sense of value and realism in art, like this wonderful painting by Courbet. But what we see is actually so much different than that. We see things that aren't there. And this is one example of an illusory contour. It comes from really an old field of Gestalt psychology. It's an illusion, so you can see, I'll see the three-dimensional sphere there, even though there's no actual line. It's the implied contour. And so in art, the idea of negative space and the idea of implied contours and objects is really important. So we sometimes see things that aren't there, and a lot of times we don't see a lot of things that are there in front of us. And this is really surprising in some ways. So this is a demonstration from psychology. And what you should do is follow the instructions on the screen here. You'll see two images switching back and forth in rapid succession. And just try to spot the difference between them. And raise your hand when you see the difference, OK? Just keep your gaze fixated on the center. You can move your attention around all over the picture. Nobody's got it yet. So this is my little version of a magic trick. One person's got it. See it? OK. I can do magic too. All right. So let's watch it again. All right. Look at the trousers on the guy on the left. All right. And now let's see what happens. Do you see him now? It's so obvious. You can't not see it. Now try not to see it. And you can't do it. You can't do it. We'll do one more to prove that wasn't a fluke. Like these. So tell me when you see it. Nobody saw it, did they? Oh, yeah, okay, a few people. Yeah, you got it, great. There's the artists in the room. Yeah, so now here's the car window on the right. And there it is. You guys are great. All right. Here comes last one. Anybody see it? Yeah? There it is. Okay. So that's a phenomenon called change blindness, right? And what it really demonstrates is how little of what we actually look at we actually see and perceive. We think we see the whole scene, but we don't. It requires a serial search, that means one location at a time, to really bind the objects together in that scene and actually see what's really there. And look at this, it's a nice a contrast. When you see this, what pops out at you? What do you see? You see Steve Jobs. Everybody sees Steve Jobs. I don't know why, because this is really just a collection of Apple computer parts, right? And you might recognize in this the an homage to the work of Chuck Close, who we'll meet later. And you know, what's remarkable about this is how automatic our global perceptions actually are. And how easy that is that comes to us. And so the idea that I'm going to talk about really today and the rest of the talk is this idea that what we see, what we feel, what we know, what we taste, and what we value really is conceptual. It's a product of what we bring to the world, just like when we see those faces in Steve Jobs. And so I think that in many ways our art is also similarly moving towards conceptual art. So this is a piece by Jordan Wolfson, a mixed media piece. I don't know what it means, maybe you do. but it certainly contains the kind of juxtaposition of real veridical photography and sort of these cartoon elements of the fantastical. And interestingly, it also juxtaposes the reality, which is poverty, and the fantasy, which is consumerism. So, and so, you know, what we see in the art is more and more what we bring to the table. What I'd like to talk about from a neuroscience point of view now is our conceptual interpretation of the world, of what we see around us, is it just an overlay on the world? Is it sort of a superficial thing that we add on to it? Or does it really deeply influence what we actually see and what we actually feel? And so that's a question that I'm very interested in from a scientific perspective. Neuroscience is an exciting field right now because there's really a convergence of many different techniques that are shedding light onto this. Some are done in humans, some in animals. I'll show you about a couple of these techniques. And this one, I think, is a kind of a work of art in itself, really. So what you see here is a mouse brain on the left. And on the right, you also see the mouse brain. And what's happened is these researchers at Stanford have found a way to make all the fat, the lipids, in that brain transparent. And they call this technique clarity. So you're actually seeing through the mouse brain right here. And what you can then do is you can stain all of the neurons different colors. So this is green fluorescent protein. And this is a fly-through movie that was created by a friend of mine, Logan Grosinick. And what you see is a small proportion of the neurons in some of the nuclei. And you get a sense of the complexity of the brain. Each neuron has 5 to 10,000 synapses with several thousand different neurons. This is the hippocampus, which is an area critical for the storage of memory. So when you lay down a memory of what I talk about tonight, then these cells in your brain are going to be active right now encoding this information. And we can start to get a picture of what the human brain looks like and is doing using magnetic resonance imaging. So this is a picture of what we have one at the university. Now every major university has one. You got to have one. And you lie down in the scanner and you slide in. And it uses very strong magnetic fields that are on all the time to basically deliver radio frequency energy to your brain and thereby perturb the atoms in the water, the protons in the water molecules. And from this magnetic resonance, or nuclear magnetic resonance, we can reconstruct a picture of the brain in three dimensions. And this won a couple of people the Nobel Prize for the ways in which this is done. But right now, we can get a picture of the whole brain from bottom to top in about half a second. And so every half a second, as you are thinking, doing, feeling, listening to music, seeing art, or whatever, we get these images of the brain. And my job as an analyst is to try to figure out which among the 300,000 or so bits of the brain that we can measure every second, and what pattern of connections across those gives rise to the states that we experience. What gives rise to the feeling of joy or the experience of sadness or the experience of beauty? And the interesting thing about this technique is you can put somebody in the scanner and you can measure lots of different things related to brain structure and related to brain function. So we can get pictures of the gray matter of the brain, how it physically changes, the white matter, which are the tracts that connect one brain region to another, the blood vessels. We can get a picture of what happens periodically as you experience pain or pleasure or another kind of feeling. We can look at the connections and the dynamics of the connections across the brain. And we can look at how they relate to what's happening in your body, to your body's physiology. We can do this in about an hour and a half. What that gives us the ability to do then is to examine the visual system, and I'll just talk a little bit about the visual system, and all these are reconstructions of magnetic resonance imaging scans. So we can inflate them, we can flatten them, we can study their different functional properties. And this is really an early view of the hierarchy of visual processing. It's a simplification, really. It's a feed-forward hierarchy, and there are, you know, 50-something named regions now, and these black lines show all the connections across them. And there's a natural progression which has a lot to do with how we perceive the world and also with some of the particular foibles of our perceptions. So this is another diagram, a computational model by my colleague in Boulder, Randy O'Reilly. And it shows sort of clearly that we have these different layers from early visual cortex, V1, to higher levels of visual cortex like V2 and V4, inferior temporal cortex, and to other areas that are essentially semantic networks. And what's happening in these early layers is these cells respond to very simple properties of things. They respond to bars of light at particular orientations. In V2, they respond to more complex object features. And by the time you get to IT, you have cells in the brain that are tuned to respond to particular very complex objects. And those tunings are shaped through experience. So if you are a postal worker in Canada and you mix numbers and letters and you look at these things all day, you will have letter areas in your brain and number areas in the brain that are all mixed up. And if your experience is such that you see these things segregated, they'll become segregated in your brain. So your brain is adapting to the input that you put in. And by the time you get up to IT and the more anterior areas of the temporal lobe here, so we're sort of going this way, right, from the back to the front of the brain, there are even cells that respond to particular concepts. So there are Jerry Seinfeld neurons. That's one of my favorites. They're Condoleezza Rice neurons in your brain that you can find. And they respond, you know, anytime Jerry Seinfeld comes on, but no other comedians. All right, probably there's a Shawn neuron somewhere now in your brain right now. And our awareness happens, you know, when do we actually become aware? Well, nobody really knows for sure, but what we think is that it happens when you go to the top. You go all the way up to the top, all the way to the frontal cortex here at the front of the brain. And then you actually become aware of things. And this is why when you look at, now here's the real Chuck Close, right? You see Chuck Close, but you don't see all the little points. You don't see this as a collection of little shapes. Because the first thing that you're aware of, what your brain has evolved to represent first, is these high gist level concepts. And that's why when you see that scene, right, the street scene I showed you in the change blindness demonstration, what you think you see the whole scene, but you really just see the gist. You don't see the details. You know, and so maybe one of the interesting things about art is capturing this gist in a new way. And I think we're sort of fascinated with Chuck Close, or at least I am, because he shows us how we can represent the gist veridically while changing all of the particulars that we think are essential to make that up. Another thing that we can look at is diffusion tensor imaging. So this is a picture of the fiber tracks throughout the brain from a human brain. Also, I think a kind of art in itself. So it's a reconstruction, and the different colors show you the different directions that these tracks are flowing. And I wanted to use this as an example of talking about connectivity. So when we think about visual perception, we think about a feed-forward hierarchy. So I just described how things go this way. They go from simple atomic elements to higher-level conceptual features and larger units. And this happens automatically, right? It happens without our effort. You can't even not see Chuck Close if you try. So it happens automatically. But what I haven't told you is that for every ascending projection this way, there are multiple fibers that go back down to the earlier parts of the cortex and shape our visual perception and what we see. And in fact, there are 4 to 10 times as many fibers projecting down from the cortex to the very earliest stages of visual processing in the thalamus as there are ascending projections. So I don't know what that means. Maybe that means 4 to 10 times of what we see is coming from our imagination rather than from the world itself. And there are other pathways that we now appreciate that we didn't really know about a few years ago. So what you see here in blue is my reconstruction. Oh, it's hard to see that, isn't it? But my reconstruction of pathways that go from your eyes to the thalamus to the visual cortex, and that's the standard feed-forward visual pathway before you even get to that first level in the hierarchy that I showed you. People used to think the thalamus was really just a relay. But there are other projections that go from your eyeballs to your other parts of the thalamus and that project to the amygdala, which is an area of the brain that is very important for perceptions of threat, for the generation of all kinds of emotional responses, for the valuation and generation of reward. And the interesting thing about this pathway that you see here in orange is that you can activate this pathway without ever knowing that you've done so at all. It can operate outside of conscious awareness. So there's this old literature on subliminal priming and subliminal advertising, right? Where they'd put, you know, naked women in the ice cubes on the Coke bottles and so on, you know? And there was a lot of sort of hocus pocus to that. I don't think a lot has come from it. However, there is a very serious and very robust literature now on subliminal priming that that shows that your brain processes much more than you're aware of seeing. So this is one example from my friend and colleague, Paul Whelan, in an experiment that he did. Now here's Chuck Close again. But did you see what happened before that? Did anybody see anything? Yeah, maybe you did. You know, this is slow. You have to present it very fast. I'll slow it down, though, so you can see it. Look again. What does that remind you of? Okay. I hope Chuck Close would be okay with that. And, you know, it wasn't Chuck Close's face that my friend Paul used, but what he did do is show people eye whites. And these eye whites were presented really fast, 33 milliseconds, actually no, 17 milliseconds, which is fast enough so that pretty much nobody can consciously see it. And you can do a test and you can make sure nobody saw anything. You can't tell. But what he showed is that if you show the fear eye whites and compare that to what happens when you see happy eye whites, right, different shape, your amygdala responds more to the fear eye whites. Totally outside of awareness. So this is a kind of a basis for subliminal influences on our perception that are pervasive. So only a fraction of what we actually are consciously aware of seeing is available to us, right? But much more is happening, and we're influenced all the time. And that's why messages that we are not aware of can sometimes influence us more strongly and be, in some sense, more dangerous in terms of our autonomy as those that we're consciously aware of and we can consciously counteract. So this is another way of creating a subliminal perception. And this is a technique called binocular rivalry. And in this technique, what happens is you present a different image to each eye. So you have to have special glasses. And what happens then, as these images are being presented to each eye, the red and the blue here, the percept is bistable. So you only see one image, and it can fluctuate back and forth over time. But you're pretty much completely unaware of what's happening in the eye that's not dominant at the time. So that's a way of studying unconscious influences. And my friend Lisa, she's the one who coined the term conceptual act, did this experiment a few years ago. And she studied what she calls gossip, what I'll call social influence. And the idea is she shows people these faces. And these faces are paired with information, like threw a chair at his classmate. I'm sure that... It's damaging. And when there's when a face was paired with negative gossip, then people rated that face more negatively for days afterwards. So don't gossip. But what's really interesting about this is what happens with binocular rivalry. So now she does the experiment where she presents these faces to one eye and then something else, these scenes, houses to the other eye. And they can ask, how often does the face emerge as the dominant percept? So how attractive is that face? Right? And this is what happens. When the face is neutral or novel, there's a moderate amount of time that the face dominates and it's perceived. When the face is associated with positive gossip, it's about the same, but with negative gossip, it tends to dominate for longer. So I got into this because I'm really interested in health and healing. I'm really interested in how our thoughts influence our perceptions of pain, influence our perceptions of our symptoms, influence the ways in which our body actually functions. So this is the Ebers Papyrus. It is the oldest known text on pharmacology. And in the Ebers Papyrus, it describes ancient medicines and healing practices. And this is from a book called 4,000 Years of Pharmacy, which is a 1926 book that I went back and found in the library. It's fascinating. What they would prescribe for people is pretty much anything that you can imagine. There are crushed up emeralds, other powdered stones, animal feces, human feces, human saliva, gallstones, which were called bezoar stones. It's a gallstone taken from the stomach of some animal. And really, any number of different things. In fact, another historian, Arthur Shapiro, documented 4,000 or so ancient remedies, all of this nature. So pretty much any animal, stone, or human thing that you could think of. And virtually none of them do we now think have any or could possibly have any actual healing properties. Many of these treatments persisted not only in ancient Egyptian times, but well into the 1800s and even the 1900s in some cases in Europe. For example, at one point in the 1800s, I think in the 1830s, in Paris, they ran out of leeches and they had to import 32 million leeches into Paris because so many people were getting bled. This is probably not going to happen to you if you go to the hospital today. I don't think that there's any known malady that can be cured by bleeding that I know of. One famous doctor during the Civil War would bleed out of the human body, this is to treat yellow fever, more blood than exists in the human body. His patients died. But the shocking thing to me is, why on earth do people keep trusting physicians? They don't seem to be getting in trouble. I'm not saying anything about physicians today, okay? It's different, right? Things are different, mostly. But you know, what strikes me is that is people's, really, their inability to tell whether they're actually getting better or not, or if they feel better, what's causing that? You know, was it, you know, that, you know, rat feces that I rubbed on me, or was it, you know, or was it something else? Would I have gotten better anyway? So people are really bad at attributions of causality. And the other thing is, maybe there's something about the act of being treated itself that is actually beneficial, right? And so, boy, if we can combine the act of care and the act of being treated with actually effective medicine, wouldn't that be terrific? You know, I have one more story. I think this is King Charles II, and he was treated. This isn't just the poor people, right? He was being treated for some malady. I don't remember. His treatment involved pigeon feces and bleeding, and he died. Okay, but I don't think his physician was blamed, right? Okay. Here's one. This. Another one. So object said to be a toad, stuck with thorns for witchcraft purposes, found with heart here exhibited. This is from a museum of ancient medicines. So when it comes to pain, and pain is a good model for studying the perception of pain and symptoms, because we know a lot about the physiology of pain. And the story of the physiology of pain has, for a long time, paralleled what I just told you about vision. People have identified particular pathways. So pain in your knee comes up here through your spinal cord, up into your brainstem and your thalamus, and you'll see it ascending into the cortex. This is where people thought the story kind of ended. And when you look at textbooks of pain, often they still end there. The pain goes up into the brain, and the percept is created, and then the pain happens. Once again, our perceptions of pain are not a veridical representation of some underlying immutable reality. They're actually things, sensations, experiences that are constructed by the brain. And just like those descending visual projections, our brain has pathways, specialized pathways for somatosensation, paralleling those in vision, that can turn the pain on and off, up and down at the spinal level. So pay attention to the yellow area, which is the ventromedial prefrontal cortex. That's going to be important here. It projects to the periaqueductal gray in the midbrain here, which projects down to the lower brainstem and right back down to the spinal cord where the first synapse is. And now we know there are what are now called on cells and off cells, that's the red and the green, that are capable of both inhibiting pain and enhancing pain at the spinal level. And in a number of studies where they create rodent models of neuropathic pain by giving the rats a very, very sad, but it's important, a spared nerve injury, a partial nerve injury, is a reliable model of pain, then it is this descending facilitation from the brain that's important for keeping the chronic pain on. And when you can change this, then you can get rid of the pain in the animal. So these circuits exist, again, I believe, for conceptual control over perception. So this is an experiment that we did looking at social influences on pain. And I conceive of this experiment as being really a very minimalistic kind of manipulation of people's experience. We can do lots of things to try to push people's experiences around. In this case, what we do is we attach a thermode to your arm, and the thermode is a computer-controlled device that gets hot according to how we program it, so it delivers safe but truly painful heat, okay, in a very controlled way. We're going to give these stimuli to people, and we're going to precede them by two kinds of cues. And here, people see this kind of display, which is just some lines, and we tell them, this is what other people rated the pain. And other people thought this particular thing that you're about to experience was pretty bad. And these lines, low pain, people thought this was okay. And we thought of this initially as an experiment on conformity. Because we know from famous early studies in psychology, like the studies of Arthur Ashe was a tennis player. Solomon, if you were all sitting in a room, or one of you was sitting in a room, judging the lengths of lines, and every other person in the room said, I think this line is longer, even if it were patently obvious that it weren't, you might be tempted to say, yes, it's longer too. You're going to agree with the group. So this is really a conformity effect, and we're thinking of this as a conformity effect. But it turns out that it's much more. So this very simple manipulation, and then what we can do is we can look at what happens to people's perceived pain as they get increasing levels of painful heat up here, the pain goes up, that all makes a lot of sense. And this is the low social cue, and what happens with the high social cue? Is it actually different? And yes, it's substantially higher. So people's ratings of pain are really influenced. Now this could be a conformity effect, like I just told you. We don't know for sure, but what's striking to me is that we also looked at people's autonomic responses to pain, and this is really a measure of skin sweating, so it's very easy to do. It happens very robustly when you get a painful stimulus. You get this increase in sweating. It's not like, you couldn't see it, but it's there, it's strong. And this is what happens in the low cue, and this is what happens in the high cue. So this isn't a conformity effect. This is an influence on a process that's affecting your body by descending projections through the brainstem. So people take medications for lots of different conditions, almost every condition that you can imagine. I was hearing today multiple sclerosis drugs for some people cost as much as $90,000 a month. People get better on all kinds of drugs for depression, for Parkinson's disease, for anxiety disorder. But it turns out that if you give them sham drugs, they often get better at about the same rate in all of those disorders. So there are substantial placebo effects. So just taking the pill can have a substantial improvement on people's clinical pain in some cases. And here I'll just show you a drop about the physiology of this. Now if we go back to our laboratory experimental model, we put people in the brain scanner, then we can get a more precise picture of what's really happening and how precisely this is affecting their pain processing. And we see ascending pain systems in blue here and descending systems that modulate those pain systems in yellow. And here's a snapshot of some important results. This was the first study that we did to show that that how your brain responds to that painful stimulus is reduced. So these are all pain-related areas, and you get a reduction in activity when you get the placebo. Another thing that happens when you get a placebo is your brain can release its own endogenous morphine-like chemicals. So opiates are the oldest drug in modern medicine's pharmacopoeia. They've been given for hundreds of years for pain and for really every other condition. They were the major reason for the opium wars in the late 1800s, when the Chinese said, "No, thank you, Britain and Europe and the US, we don't want your opium. We don't want it to be sold here because it's hurting our people and they're becoming addicts." And the British said, "Oh no, we're going to close your ports and open your ports and come in and sell it anyway." So it's had a long and checkered history. And right now, there's a huge epidemic in opioid overdose, both prescription opioids and heroin, which is also an opiate, cause about 30,000 deaths per year in the U.S. combined. So it's an epidemic that affects all of us. But you know, what is the opioid system for in the first place? Why do you have this? And the reason that you have opioid receptors in the first place is so that what you think about pain, whether it's safe or damaging, whether you're going to be disabled or functional, whether there are long-term consequences or not, so that those thoughts can shape your perception. So here, when people get a placebo treatment, a fake treatment, there's an increase in opioids in all these yellow and red regions here. And one of the major centers for opioid production in the brain is the PAG here, which is a major important center for pain control. As I said before, it also sends projections down to the spinal cord that can block signals that are coming up that are pain related. So this is another study here that shows increases in activity with the placebo in really all of the major centers in the brainstem that are important for that descending control of sensation. And a really interesting study where people looked at functional MRI of the spinal cord, so they can look at what's happening in the spinal cord at the first synapse coming in as people get a placebo. And what happens is there's responses to pain in the spinal cord, and with the placebo, those responses are damped down. So there are effects even at the very earliest stages of perception. So now, this is something that might disturb you, so you know, close your eyes if you don't want to see it. This is a person who's getting a molar removed, a third molar extraction. I told you I talk to, you know, medical people a lot. So there it comes. All right. Though the funny thing is, this man is not under any sedation. He has taken no drugs at all. He is hypnotized. And he is conscious. And you can't hear this in the video, but what he's being asked is, "How much pain are you in now?" And he's like, you know, he's like, "How do you feel?" He's like, "Oh, good. It's like a 4. It's like a 4. And it's like a 2. It's like a 1. It's a 0. I don't know." And he's pulling his tooth out. So, you know, you can try that at home if you're highly hypnotizable. But, you know, I've been fascinated by hypnosis. I think it's crazy. But I also think that there's a way in which people can make themselves make this state of consciousness available to them, that they can actually let go and they can allow their conceptual system to have strong control over their perceptions. So a couple of principles. The brain is predictive. So why all these effects exist is because the brain doesn't really care about exactly what's in front of you now or what you're seeing now. What it really cares about is what it means for the future. So the brain is constantly making predictions. And here's one example. Forget about the cortex and the higher level brain centers. This is your retina, and there's actually a very complicated circuitry in your retina. And it turns out that cells in your retina don't just respond to objects, they will predict the location of a moving object and fire in advance. And if that didn't happen, you couldn't see a quickly moving object. It would just go by too fast. So your retina is actually calculating and predicting the whole time. And if a system as simple as this, relatively speaking, can do that, what is the rest of your brain doing, right? More elaborate predictions about farther events into the farther future. Another principle, the brain is dynamic. I mentioned this before, it rewires itself all the time based on your experience and based on how you interpret the world and how you see the world. And so I just have this little movie. It's going to go through some different memory systems. We think of the hippocampus as being a center for memory storage, and it is. That allows you to store conscious declarative memories, like anything that you might have heard tonight. And so the cells in that area of the brain have to rewire continually every time you store a new memory. There are also new neurons being born in your hippocampus all the time, even if you're an adult. The amygdala learns associations with threat, among other things. The ventral striatum learns associations with reward, so things that you value and motivate, and then those motivations can become stamped in for you. If you do something that you like over and over again, that can pick up steam, and that's because of plasticity, structural changes in the striatum. Drugs of abuse are also thought to work that way. Habit learning, physiological conditioning, taste and visceral sensation, motor conditioning and learning, perceptual learning, learning about tasks and rules. So they're really interesting examples of all these things. I won't give you examples of all of them. You know, I'll just give you two quick ones. But the point is, every system in your brain is capable of rewiring itself from your spinal cord all the way up to your prefrontal cortex. So one example is, if you practice a perceptual task over and over and over again, the cells in your visual cortex will change, even as an adult. And they will become essentially better at doing the kind of information processing that you ask them to do. So in summary, then, perception is constructed. It's not something that happens to us, it's something that we do. I'm going to talk for a few more minutes, if I can, sort of a last section. And this is really about conception and about meaning, because I believe that it is our sense of meaning and value that we impart to things that really is the top-level driver of all of these different effects. And if our perceptions are so influenced by what we think and believe, then how much more so should our values and our emotions be affected? You know, we don't all go around hallucinating, okay? And so our effects on our visual perception are, you know, they're limited. They're under the hood. We don't see them. But the effects on value is pervasive. And there's something about this area of the ventral medial prefrontal cortex that's really important. I've already mentioned that it's important for placebo effects. And it's important for shaping sensory experiences, like our pain experiences. It's also part of what's now called the default mode network in the brain, which is so named because it is the most active part of the brain at rest. It's what's consuming a major proportion of your brain's glucose right now. So it's constantly working for you. And what is it doing when it's working so hard? It goes up in activity when you engage in spontaneous thought, in memories, especially memories about yourself, in imagination, in prospection about the future. If you imagine a rich idea of the future, your future vacation to Hawaii, or the sculpture that you're going to create, you know, or whatever it is, then this system is particularly active. And even really very simple and elementary thoughts about yourself. So if I asked you, you know, imaginative, how does that word apply to you? Give me a 1 to 10 rating. Making that comparison would activate this system in the brain. The act of self-reference. It's also really important when you're using your thoughts to generate positive emotions and negative emotions. And when you're evaluating things as simple as the likelihood of winning a $5 bill, you know, any kind of reward, or whether you want to take cocaine tomorrow or today or right now, you know. And if this system is strongly sensitized to those rewards, it has learned, and there's plasticity that that has driven it to respond very strongly to those cues, you're going to want whatever it is that it's telling you to want, which impinges on your personal freedom. So what's common to all of these things that we think is really important is that this is a system in the brain for conceptual appraisal. And appraisal is a word that we use in emotion theory. And what it really means is thinking of oneself in context. What is the situation that I'm in right now? What is the outlook for the future? Is this going well or badly? And a host of other things, you know, how are others relating to me? And it's this this appraisal system that is the main generator of emotional responses in humans. So all of our responses are how we think about things. And so it's this system in the brain that responds in proportion to the value you place on something like a bottle of wine. So this is a study, a sort of well-known study now, Hilke Plasman and colleagues took some wine aficionados, put them in the scanner, and they gave them the same bottles of wine, but they told them that some bottles were $90 bottles of wine, and this area of the brain goes up. And they told them that other matched bottles are $10 bottles of wine, not so good. Right, okay, so this is a value encoding region. And when Samir Zaki and other people have written their books on aesthetics, and what is it in your brain that correlates with a particular piece of art like this Vermeer, this gorgeous Vermeer, when you're looking at this, the more you like it, what tracks that? Well, it's the ventromedial PFC. Right there. And you can see the logic of this quickly kind of breaks down. It doesn't mean that Vermeer is like a bottle of wine. You know, this also responds to candy bars and hats, if you like hats, and really anything else that you like. It responds to healthy foods if you're dieting, etc. Okay, so what we think is happening is this is important for generating the meaning response. And I like to think of the brain as a series of pattern generators. So what it does is it recognizes events in the world and it generates a coordinated response that's adaptive for those events. It's a little hot right here, I'm sorry. So right now, some part of your brainstem is responding to that and is engaging in thermoregulation, or at least mine is, okay? That's right down in here, all right? Higher up, you have affective pattern generators. If you separate these areas, like the PAG that I was telling you about, from the rest of the brain, and you stimulate them in a cat, let's say, with electrodes, what happens? You get full-blown emotional behaviors with teeth baring, claws, physiological responses, blood pressure goes up. You get full-blown defensive reactions without the rest of the brain involved at all. And what this system of the brain is for relating with your environment. So it's an organism-environment relational system that operates at a higher level. And what is this cortex for then? This big thing, it's not just to keep the rest of your brain warm, although I've heard people say that. What it's for is to generate a picture of the self in context that is more abstract, that reaches farther into the future, that considers your retirement plans and how your children are going to be when they grow up and other things like that, and integrates them into your sense of how you're doing now. And there are many influences then in this the VMPFC. So there are different parts of the brain that are specialized for things like the place that you are and for particular memories that you have, that's the hippocampus, for expectations about the future here in the orbitofrontal cortex, for feelings coming from your body, well, which the insula is very important for. And your brain is constantly surveilling your body right now. And the social context, which is very important. This is actually me holding my wife's hand during the birth of our third child. And it turns out social support during childbirth, very important. Great pain relief. Okay. So what the VMPFC is doing is putting all these things together into a picture of the self in context. And when you go then to a piece of art, you know, I'm not an artist, but how do you evaluate this kind of work? This is a work by local artist Bill Stair, and he paints these sort of horrible, gorgeous portraits. And what he's done here is several things that are really interesting. So for one thing, he's capitalized on something that is innate and hardwired in us, which is the perception of faces and the tuning to faces, which is there in us. And he's also, you have these shades of threat, right? But it's ambiguous. So there's a hint of violence, and you're not sure what it is. And so it's both familiar and unfamiliar at the same time. And I think that's important because what it's doing is presenting something to you that you can get your mind wrapped around, but it's doing it in a new way and bringing you into a new place by doing so. And there's some other things, too, that create this sense of novelty and sense of ambiguity in the familiar. And one thing he's told me is that if you look at the symmetry of the face, the two halves of the face are actually quite different. And he paints them that way on purpose. So your brain is seeing two different things now and trying to integrate those two things. You know, so is she alive or is she dead? Is she a ghost? Is she a victim or is she a survivor? And we don't know. And I think that what is interesting about that, and one of the interesting things about art to me then, is that kind of ambiguity allows the viewer the space to put themselves into the picture. Because it's that ambiguity, it's not given to you, so you can relate this to yourself in some way, and everybody does in a different way, you know. So I'd like to go back to the brain for one last final thought, which is, I'm going to go back to the ventromedial prefrontal cortex because that's what I love, and to think about this. So what does it respond to in addition to value and thinking about yourself and all that stuff? Well, there's some weird things it responds to. It responds very well to semantics and to spatial navigation. Now, why is that interesting? It's interesting because of what it means for the self. Now, if you think about what are semantics, well, it's how you represent the words, the network of words. If I say a word like breath right now, think about what breath means for you, what it is for you. What it reminds you of, what other words come to mind, like maybe kundalini or something, I don't know, right? And what semantics are is this vast web of relationships, and your mind, your concept, conceptual thought spreads from one to another in this web. And this is, I think, you know, new work is showing this is what this system in the brain, the ventromedial prefrontal cortex, the third eye, is doing. It's helping you represent this conceptual space of all the things that this might remind you of and the ways in which it relates to other things. So it's your semantic network, but it goes far beyond words. And the interesting thing about it is it includes a concept of the self. So what does it mean for something to be valuable, for you to like something? Well, it has to be valuable to you. And who's the you in all that? We have this implicit or explicit sense of ourselves. And I think that how we develop that is by putting ourself in with all these other objects and ideas and things in this network. And it's this system in the brain that helps us to relate these things to ourselves. Is this close to me or far away? So it's this idea of representing this web in a multidimensional space that has allowed us to form a concept of self, which has allowed us to actually consciously value things, to like them or dislike them. And so that's a little bit about art. I'm going to end there. Thank you very much.
I was... I'm really close to this mic. I was wondering if your research in the motions has gone anywhere into like the flow state, like that kind of. I don't know if you know what I'm talking about. You do probably.
It is. It is the state of being completely absorbed in one thing, in what you're doing, which people find very enjoyable, and they seek it out. So I don't think we know what it is in the brain that creates a flow state yet, but I suspect that it has a lot to do with integration of these various systems so that you don't have competing goals, so you're not thinking about anything else, and sort of a very strong coherence across the systems that generate a sense of motivation and value. So.
All right, thanks.
Hello. I noticed in the presentation that you had the list of the five senses on there, and a lot of the presentation was about visual perception. But I'm pretty sure I didn't see sound on the senses that you had there. I'm curious if your work ever does involve sound or anything with that with your
Yeah, work. That's a good question. So I picked vision because people like to look at things, and then I picked pain because we study that. So we don't study sound very much, but the same principles really apply. So there's inherent ambiguity, right, when you perceive sounds. So your brain is constantly imposing a top-down mindset in order to even interpret and make sense of sounds, which is why if you're learning a foreign language or listening to a foreign language, if you don't speak it well, it just goes by so fast, it's very hard. So there's a ton of conceptual knowledge that's brought to bear in even understanding speech and sound. And it works for all sensory modalities too. So you can. There's other studies that in taste, for example. So if you tell somebody something is horrible, stinky socks, it's going to taste really bad. People even in some studies in the scanner have thrown up because they're getting this bitter thing, and then they're told it's something really bad, right? And if you're told it's something better, it's not so bad. So how you think about that really matters a lot.
How do you deal with people with brain damages? And do you do any research on that perception?
Yeah, I think the thing about brain damage is it's so varied, in what its effects are. And I think that the literature has focused on some success cases. Like if some of you have read Oliver Sacks, you might have heard of The Man Who Mistook His Wife for a Hat is a guy who's got a lesion in a very specific face recognition module. And so he's got this very circumscribed deficit. There aren't that many such modules. And if you think about the emotional brain, there is no one spot in the brain that you can damage that produces any specific deficit in emotion. There are patients who have strange, specific emotional things, but it's nothing systematic. And when you damage the brain, so when you damage the area that I was showing you here, the third eye area, what happens to you? Well, people have a lot of trouble deciding what they value. So Antonio Damasio described that. They can't make decisions. They can make lists of pros and cons of having the salad or the steak, but they can't actually make a decision. That's one of the things. And they display another thing, which is really interesting, which is from the 1920s, characterized by a neurologist named Lhermitte, called utilization behavior. And what that means is they're really bound to the environment to tell them what to do. So if you had such a lesion and I put a makeup kit in front of you, you would feel compelled to put on makeup, even if you didn't like it. Another case, he puts this is the Dr. Lhermitte, the guy comes in with this, he's got the lesion, he puts a urinal on the desk, and the guy uses the urinal, like right in the office. Right? So whatever's in your environment, you have to use that. And so in some sense, our sense of free will and agency is disrupted.
Sort of on that same note, Shawn, do you utilize, Tor's talking a lot about like the power of suggestion and like the environment even, like these things. Do you use that same type of technique in magic at all? I mean,
absolutely. Magicians capitalize on that all the time. For various different techniques, for example, doing the picture, at one point I asked her to pick the color that she was the most adverse to, and then likewise I asked her to pick the color that was most attractive to her. So, that wasn't exactly the method, but right. I mean I do utilize that sort of thing in different routines, and so I can make very educated guesses, you know, based on who I'm picking to come up. You know, I'm picking up a woman to, you know, and I can generally guess ahead of time that she's not going to like red. You know what I mean? So,
okay.
That's interesting.
Yeah.
So I know there's a whole, a whole, you know, neuroscience of magic and related to principles of attention. Is that something that you focus on, or what are the principles that you think are important?
It's not something it's only something I've actually been interested in the last couple of years. It's kind of what I was trying to explore with that experiment at the very beginning with the lemon and the knife. There's a great book, I apologize, I can't think of the name of the book, but it's written by a gentleman by Peter Lamont, who's a British psychologist and scientist, but he's also a magician. And it's all about how magicians take advantage of attention blindness. And that's why I was really particularly interested in the beginning of your talk, where you were talking about how there can be two different images, but we only focus on one image at a time, we can only see that. Some of you may have seen there's a couple of interesting YouTube experiments where you have a group of people in the room and they're passing a ball. And your job is to count how many times that ball has passed from hand to hand to hand.
Oh, yeah.
And in the end, you know, it'll say, how many did you get? Did you get 25 times, 15 times? Did you see the guy in the gorilla suit walk through the room? And most people didn't see it because their brain was so focused on tracking that ball being passed around that they didn't see the person in the gorilla suit walk through the room. And
it's not going to work on you now.
Right. So I personally have been very fascinated with that and how magicians can take advantage of that. I mean, that's the core of sleight of hand and misdirection. And I think misdirection is kind of an improper term. I think it's actually direction, because I'm going to direct your attention over here and take advantage of the fact that you and do something over here. Mm-hmm. And because I know that if you're watching here, you're not going to be able to watch over here. So I think there's a lot of correlation to it. It's pretty interesting.
I was wondering if the same like image blindness happens with the different senses as well. Because you were talking about the overlay. So like, can you hear two different things but only focus on one? Like, does that make sense to what I'm asking?
Oh yeah, I see. There's a whole class of things that's ambiguous percepts, right? I think if that's what you mean. So the best example is vision. And I'll show you something, because this is the design thing. So I was in Berlin a couple weeks ago and I gave a talk, and after the talk, they gave me this. And see what it looks like. This is there's a group of PhD students, very enterprising, and they've created a company that creates these. And what it is, it's a bistable percept. So it looks like a duck or a bunny. It's actually a cutting board. And and so you can see sort of one or the other, but not both, right? So there's a whole bunch of these things. They're most famous in vision. I don't know how many there are. I don't know how easy it is to get them in other kinds of sensory modalities.
You just totally spoilered my invisible gorillas assignment. It's okay.
What was that?
I have an assignment for my seminar class that's invisible gorillas, and you you spoilered it, so I won't be able to show that video.
Sorry.
It's okay.
I would encourage anybody that's interested in this. There's a great series called Brain Games, and if you guys don't watch it, you've got to check it out. For the first several seasons, a really dear friend of mine named Paulo Robbins, who is a professional thief, was the main guy on that show. He's a magician and pickpocket, and he demonstrates a lot of really, really fascinating techniques of the way the brain can't see two things, and or does see, like part of it goes into subconscious and other parts don't, and it's really pretty fascinating. I know you can get them on DVD, and they're on Netflix.
I know that they've done a lot recently with animal brain imaging, and it seems like that's changing the way that we understand animal cognition pretty significantly, and I'm wondering if that's overlapped at all into your research.
It has. You know, I actually, one of my colleagues did get $10 million to to develop a dog imaging program commercially. So Greg Burns, he, you know, is will scan your dog and tell you if your dog loves you or loves chocolate. supposedly. I think the way in which interacts with my research is, I think there's been this theme throughout that animals are just bundles of reflexes that they don't really think or feel, or they don't conceive of things, right? They don't have expectations about the future. And I think there's a whole series of studies that's really suggesting that that's not the case. That animals, the classic experiment is a fear conditioning experiment. It's a tone shock. And there's a lot of work now that says that it's not just the pairing of those things, like, you know, Pavlov's dog too with the bell, right? It's not just the pairing or the contingency that's important. It's actually the animal's awareness of the contingency and what it means that's important. And so that I find fascinating, because I think it turns out that animals have a much more complex cognition than we think.
My question is about meditation. I have read a few articles generally about meditation and how it affects your brain, and that it affects your brain. Usually the studies that I'm reading, which are not exactly academic studies, more like mind, body, green kind of stuff, but say that it happens in a fairly short period of time. So I would kind of wonder about more details about meditation in your brain.
There's work in science that suggests that your brain's gray matter structure changes when you meditate. You know, I think I'm a little bit skeptical of such things, but I think it's really a possibility. Because lots of things that you do can change your brain's wiring. So if you experience chronic or intense stress as an animal, you can see remodeling of neurons in the brain within several days. Or when you create this chronic pain model, you can see remodeling of neurons within several days. So it really does change your brain. It changes the morphology of the cells. And people have said the same thing about meditation. But I don't know. I think we're still in the middle of doing a lot of research on that. And so I think we'll have to see what happens with more studies and how that plays out.
I actually had a question for you. In the magic community, we have a term that we call muscle memory, right, which is also used in sports and that sort of thing. But we use it in magic too, because as a magician, particularly doing close-up sleight of hand type of magic, you want everything to be muscle memory, because you also have to concentrate on presentation. I can't be sitting thinking about what moves I'm going to do. I have to be thinking about how I'm going to present this. Yeah. So the moves actually have to become automatic. And is the muscle memory that part of the rewiring that you're talking about? Is that your brain becomes accustomed to a particular action and it just it rewires and becomes an automatic thing?
Yeah, absolutely. So any stimulus response mapping that you do moves through stages from becoming more controlled and more attention demanding to becoming more automatic. A lot of that happens in the basal ganglia, in the dorsal stratum. There's a whole pathway to habit formation, including sequences of movements and sequences of responses to cues too. So basically, anything you do consistently, you tend to automate if you do it in the same way. Mm-hmm. Another interesting thing, going back to sort of brain plasticity and structural changes, is I think it is pretty well established now that if you practice something for a very long time, so juggling is another thing that can change your motor cortex in your brain, and playing piano. So if you're a pianist and you play for a long time, then you change the representations in motor cortex of those things. And what's interesting to me is that it also, how much plasticity or change in your brain you get seems to depend on how important or how salient that practice is for you. And you can boost it in some studies in animals, in monkeys. You can boost that by boosting essentially neurotransmitters like acetylcholine in the basal forebrain that flood these things with importance-related signals.
Interesting.
So deliberate practice is good. I want to say one more thing about the meditation. We're doing a meditation study to reduce pain, and a lot of people think that that's actually a good way, a drug-free way to change pain experience long-term. I think it's very promising. So people really focus on meditation and mindfulness and things like acceptance. And so it probably has a lot of potential to undo some of the negative consequences of stress on your brain.
Okay, we're all going to take all up right. meditating, I guess, yeah. now. I'm a big proponent of meditating. If you're, let's thank you. Let's give a round of applause.